Yeah, welcome everyone to the big PyData BBQ this year. I'm really thrilled. We have like over 200 people sign up, but if you count, not everybody will be here. Many people join us remotely on YouTube and LinkedIn and Twitter. So I'm pretty excited. So the big PyData BBQ is always really important to us. It's like our main event in the year. So welcome. Welcome you all. And just a short disclaimer, we're recording this meetup, so we're also taking pictures. So that's not by surprise. This is PyData Heidelberg number 12. It's actually the 25th PyData Südwest. So. Quite a while. And so, welcome everybody here on site in Heidelberg and at home at the screens. So, and a little bit more I want to say to those who join remotely. This is actually, we're here located in Heidelberg. Here you see, this is how it looks like, the old town of Heidelberg, center of German Romanticism, but also one of the oldest universities in Europe and the world. It was founded 1386, right? Yes, people from the university. They say approve it. Yes, that. So it's pretty old. It's pretty great. It's a nice town. I'm a bit biased maybe because I was also born and raised here. So, but I wanted to show you a little bit, especially people who are joining remote who never heard. Because when I go to conferences, I always say, "Oh, you're from Germany. You're cool. You're from Berlin." I said, "No, I'm not from Berlin. I'm from Southwest Germany." And then people basically think, of course, Berlin is the capital. In most countries, the capital is the economic and intellectual, well, like, center of universities, and we said, no, that's Germany is federal, and look just at the universities, and especially at the excellence universities, as we call them here in Germany. Most of them are actually pretty close. So we're in a really good area, and also like a really good neighborhood with other universities. And also, if we look at the important companies and their headquarters in Germany, you see, like, hey, there's a lot of stuff going on here. So this is a really good place to be, to invent. It's also like a very inventive area from all the time, yeah, because people here can no longer hear it, but you know, like in this area, the automobile was invented, many other very machine building excellence and many other things are invented here. And down in the south, everybody knows Daimler, everybody knows Porsche, and they are here in south, and in Munich, BMW and many other companies. You know, so this is like a little pitch, say, hey, little bit reality check Germany. This is how Germany looks like to you at the screams. But enough promotion of the South. That I show you another nice picture of from the other angle. You will recognize there's the castle over there, and we are in the Mathematikon. You see on the in the left corner, the Mathematikon is located in the Neuenhammerfeld. It's like in the old town. We have people who study law, philosophy, and Neuenhammerfeld is physics, math, and also the German Cancer Research Institute, and a lot of healthcare. So we're also like a really high-tech neighborhood here. So enough promotion about Southwest. So it's now about you. Please raise your hand if you join us for the first time. Wow, it's awesome. So I would say, like, again, like 60% are like newcomers, so welcome. This is very important for us. This is interactive, so it's not just like a lecture. You listen, and so you can also ask questions. We have Slido. There's a link to a QR code. You can just go to Slido, have a link in the Q&A session. Ines will be happy, or also the panelists will be happy to answer your questions or listen to your thoughts there. So, welcome. Yes, has everybody a name tag? Yes, everybody? No? So yes, and we can get one later outside because that's the thing. Who knows the Pac-Man rule? Good? Okay, you've all been to PyCon in Berlin. Right. So, what's the Pac-Man rule? I think it's very important for us. This is a community where we help each other. So there are no stupid questions. We want to include people who are new and also like people are probably a little bit shy. So if you stand with many people in a circle, never close the circle. Always leave a gap open so somebody can fly in and start a conversation, say hi, and let just people listen to your conversations, because I think it's always like a great opportunity to share knowledge and yeah, get to know new people. So that's the Pac-Man rule. So PyData Südwest, what is PyData Südwest? PyData Südwest, so PyData is a series of user groups all around the world from NumFOCUS. NumFOCUS is a US-based foundation who supports the development and maintenance of all these packages. And who has at least used one of these packages once? Yes, everyone, almost every, yeah. So it's important because open source is also not just like, yeah, these packages are really, a lot of them are really in production. So we need professional maintenance there as well. We need people also to get paid to implement new features. And NumFOCUS is a foundation that supports the development of these packages. So they do a great job. Actually, it's like almost 12 years now. It's not nothing new. This is pretty like 12 years already. For us, it's also really important that we are a respectful, inclusive community. So we have a code of conduct. So we don't tolerate any harassment of community members in any form for any reason. So if you have any questions, need help, or if you feel there's something you are uncomfortable with, just talk to one of the organizers. So I'm an organizer. Like all organizers raise their hand if they're not tweeting. Like here, there's Kevin, there's Uwe, there's Sia. So we can, just talk to us. Or if you want to do an anonymous report, just go to the website, NumFOCUS, and report it. So meetup. So actually, PyData meetup. We also have a YouTube channel. So PyData meetup. So there's more than 200,000 members worldwide now, in 76 countries. Probably this. I took this like a month ago. So maybe it's 80 already. I don't know. So this is like a growing community for 10 years, and it's all around the world. And there's meetups everywhere. And we are just like here in the middle of it. As we record and stream this meetup and also release the talk and the panel later on YouTube, for us is very important, especially to release the conference talks as well, because it's very important we share the knowledge we present also with the world, or something new or findings or if whatever is useful there. So check out the YouTube channel. There's quite a few videos now. So PyData Südwest, so actually we're also like 5 years now, unbelievable, right? So Südwest, why we did Südwest, so actually Uwe and we did PyCon.de in Karlsruhe in 2017 and 18, and we had a PyData track, and then we moved PyCon.de to Berlin and basically merged with PyData Berlin to one conference, but we really missed PyData. Said, hey, we should have like a local chapter. And then Uwe's from Karlsruhe said, yeah, let's do PyData Karlsruhe. And I said, no, let's do PyData Heidelberg. And then we said, okay, if we open a PyData chapter in this area, this would be quite ridiculous. So hey, let's join forces and just settle for Südwest. And I'm also like really happy because to announce we have a new city. Yeah, Heilbronn, a city you probably have never heard of, but like, yes, I'm sorry. Yeah, it's like true. But it's very strong with industry. For example, Lidl, the discounter headquarters is very close there. There's a lot of like highly skilled champions of the German Mittelstand. And yeah, so we're really happy Heilbronn has just joined. We also have like immense growth in the past weeks. We are now 1,600 members now. That's more like 200-300 people added. I stopped counting. So ping us if you want to host us, if you want to sponsor us, help us to run a meetup or contribute a talk or a lightning talk. There's a QR code. Just go to the website and check it out. So because for us it's important, we are not here just to entertain you. Yeah, it's like community is always like give and take. So we will be very happy if you want to contribute a talk of your latest research, something you've learned, whatever is in our domain of Python data and AI. So we couldn't do that without our sponsors. So I'm really happy that we have Heidelberg University, High Innovation, like hosting this meetup. Here's Johanna. She will tell you a little bit more about High Innovation in a minute. So she's providing the venue, food and drinks. Also happy my company Königsweg, my partner Zia over there, who will tell you a little more about Königsweg in a minute for event organization and food. And also I would like to thank the Python Software Verband, who supports this meetup also financially. And now I would like to introduce Johanna to you, but we need a microphone for you. Here you go.
Okay.
So.
Working. Yes.
Thanks,
Alex.
Yes,
a very warm welcome from my side as well.
I'm really very
happy to see the screen so packed.
It's turned off.
Oh, oh, sorry.
Not working?
No, it's turned off. Sorry. Sorry, we have to repeat that. Sorry. Yeah, it's production, live production. It's not as easy as we think, yes. So welcome, Johanna. Yeah, thank you.
Better? Sorry. Okay,
yeah,
so,
yeah.
Well, you can't have enough warm welcomes, right? So again, welcoming you here and online and everywhere to this meeting. I'm really happy to see this room so packed. That's what I was
I'm just fixing the camera.
Saying. what are you doing there?
Yes.
It's the 25th PyData Southwest meeting. You said it's the second year at the University of Heidelberg, which I'm really very happy that this is happening. So I'm Johanna. I'm an innovation scout at High Innovation, which is a transfer agency of the University of Heidelberg. And our mission is to enable technology and knowledge transfer, offering that service to everyone at the university, from students to professors and anyone else who wants to do a transfer project. How do we do that? We support founders or founders-to-be with their startup or spin-off ideas. We do networking within the university and outside the university realm. We scout for any interesting transfer projects. We do education or training with the aim to get some entrepreneurial spirit into the university. And we do quite a lot of specific innovation projects like an expert database, industry on campus, incubators, and in general, defining and adapting a generous transfer strategy at the university. So what do we want to achieve with that? We want to strengthen the social impact with a more strategic or more structured transfer strategy, basically. We create networking opportunities and visibility for that, whatever is happening in terms of transfer. We enable more interdisciplinary approaches for research or for collaboration with stakeholders in and outside the university, because we think that changing your perspective really substantially helps to come to innovative ideas and new ideas. And we do transfer in a quite multidimensional way, really trying and using different pathways to make it possible. So all in all, our aim is to bring complex science into application or to achieve a broader or access to a wider audience with really a lot of different partners in and outside the university. And that very much aligns with what PyData Southwest is aiming at, I think. And that's why I'm really, really happy to host this meeting. And I'm looking forward to inspiring talks later on and networking with all of you over the barbecue later on. Thanks, and I'm passing on to Sia, I think.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. So I'm Sia. What's happening here? White screen, okay, why not? So actually, content that you would see here would be basically on our website, königsweg.com, so I will bore you with my picture. So I'm together with Alex, one of the partners at Königsweg, and happen to be also the managing director. So Königsweg is a data science and AI consultancy, maybe many of you know, so I see a lot of familiar faces, and I'm super happy to finally have you all here in Heidelberg. So what we do is, at this white screen, you would see how the industries we are active on, which financial services, pharmaceutical industry, but also public sector. And what you would also see on this white screen, if it would, if it would, there is our strong heritage and dedication to open source. So we contribute here ever since. It is in our DNA. I think you can see this by Alexander being like my diehard partner on this and constantly convincing me for since 2015, let's focus on that. And I'm super happy that we went this path because we understand that through to this access that we have, we can bring all these tools and or concepts into the industry doing a real impact. And today, here in Heidelberg, for us, it's very important that it is, as usual, about food on different levels. So the one food is the brain food, where I'm very happy to welcome you, Ines, and looking forward to your keynote. And then after that, we will also have some barbecue for for meat lovers, and also, as we are diverse, also for the non-meat lovers. So then we will do some announcements later how this will go. Looking forward to communicate with you. So in any kind of form, would you like to interact with us at Königsweg, whether you would like to collaborate with us, work with us, as usual, as a employee and or freelancer or customer or advisor or just contributor in any way or form, happy to contact and communicate with you. And for us, it's a pleasure to be here and support this PyData Südwest. And basically, as we said, Berlin still is the capital. That's why we are committed to PyCon. But looking here to familiar faces, I'm really happy to see you here. Thank you very much.
Right, thank you, Sia. So, what else? So, we have started a LinkedIn group. Oh yes, camera, hello. Du kannst ja auch einfach drehen. No, so. Hello, camera, hello, here, no, here, camera. AI, hey. Oh, no, now it's got me. Ready to check? Ah, this is also right. Okay, again. Now it has me, right? It's a little, no. Anyway, because I think it's very important we have a group where we can also like announce and chat or like exchange. So I've thought about multiple because there's so many social media, and so we said, okay, let's do a LinkedIn group so we can reach you and you can reach us. So just join our LinkedIn group. There's a QR code. It's a moderated spam-free environment, so we won't have anybody like just spam there. So it's just like to get you up to date with this meetup here and nothing else and no noise. Help us grow. Invite people who haven't heard about us. Just invite them to join the group. And yeah, so this is our agenda for today. We have Ines has arrived. However, we were starting late, a little worried, but I knew she was here because we had, of course, we visited the castle earlier, so I know she was in Heidelberg. So now we're running late. So actually, I think, what's the time now? So yeah, we probably start like in 5 minutes with Ines' talk, and then like 20 minutes after 7 with the barbecue once we have. Yeah. So yeah, it's always really bad to be the talk before the food, between the food. Yeah, now also like, yeah, right. So, and then we have the panel with Alejandro Saucedo, Alina Lenhardt, Ines, Michael Gertz, who's there. Alina just wrote me and is looking for the entrance. So she will be over here in a minute. And then we have lightning talks. We have one lightning talk slot available because one lightning talk speaker reported in 6. So if you have a lightning talk, let me know. Oh, yes, laptop. Yeah, lightning talk. Okay, and then after lightning talks, we have networking. So for the barbecue, we go outside. And then for the panel and the lightning talks, we come back in this room here. So, and then the question is, where is Alessandro? Yeah, because we haven't seen him around here. So the problem is Alessandro got sick and is in bed. So, but we have solutions. So he will join us later remotely for the panel. So so he'll be around remotely for the panel. He's like, he was pretty destroyed. He was really looking forward to come here to beautiful Heidelberg. But yeah, well, if you're sick, you cannot travel or should not travel. And but he will join in remotely later. So we have two lightning talks, Bela and Irina. More about that later. We have some community announcements. And who likes pizza? And now I have to see if Jessica is still around. Who likes pizza? Nobody? Yeah. And it's not, oh, there's no barbecue, there's pizza now later. No. Who likes pizza? Okay. Yeah, okay. Most of you. I thought so. So, yes. So, let me check. I'll have to actually switch here. Because I have an announcement. We have an announcement of pizza, but... We have an announcement pizza, but I'm not sure if Jessica is still here because we connected like more than half an hour ago. Oh, there she is. Welcome. So welcome, Jessica. Say something so we can check if we can hear you.
Hi, everyone.
Wonderful.
Having an amazing time.
Yes.
There you are.
Wonderful. I don't know. I can turn off the subtitles. Yeah. So Jessica was a speaker at last... at the last PyData BBQ last year, and she's also like an amazing organizer of PyLadies Berlin. But I think you're not talking about PyLadies tonight, right?
No, something slightly different. My background might give it away a little bit. First of all, sorry I cannot be there today. I'm joining you again. Last year was amazing. Thank you so much. But I'm traveling tomorrow, so I make another trip. I wanted to share with everybody just a little bit about another upcoming event that we have in the German Python world coming up this year, which will be, I don't know if my slides up, but...
I will show the slide in a minute. Yes, I can show the slide. So just here. So we can, so people can see the slide now. So I'll make that big again, but switch back to you.
Okay.
All right, yeah.
So if you're not familiar, it's a conference where all the talks are 10 minutes long. So very, very manageable, very approachable. We welcome first-time speakers, welcome non-first-time speakers. There will be pizza at this conference.
Surprise.
So, I don't know what operating really anybody would need. It's going to be in Hamburg. We've got a great location. It will be like full day with maybe some after hour kind of activities happening as well. Our CFP is open. So if I need to say again, please apply with your talks.
I did.
Looking forward to receiving them. You can get tickets on the website. And we will also have some small grants for travel. So if this is something that's a concern for you, you can write us an email. You can find that on the website. And we'll try and be as accommodating as possible. So, yeah, Alex, Sandra, you've been there before. So you can maybe attest to how awesome this conference is.
It was amazing. I will be there. Even if you don't accept my talk, I will be there. I will be there. Yes, of course. All right.
Deciding on the fly, the speakers.
Thank you. Thank you so much for joining in personally. Safe travels. And bye-bye. And I'll show the slide with the details again. No. Thank you. Okay. Bye-bye. Okay. Bye-bye. So, here we are now. Okay, I'm confused. So, no, I don't want to do that. So, that's... So, you remember all that, right? And, there's the slides here. Wow! Interesting. So, we've seen that, So, here's quick Python pizza. You can also QR code. You can also reach out to us. We will send you back, and it's an amazing event. So, next, who likes dinner? Okay, not so many. Maybe you like this? Oh, it's that. That's the BCC in Berlin, and this is how it looks inside. And look, very empty seat. Paula and me on the stage there. And this is actually, like, I'm really happy to announce the next conference of PyCondi and PyData Berlin for 2024. It's going to be in April 22nd to 24th. We're just building the committees. If you want to be informed about tickets, opening of CFP, just go to the website links, join up our newsletter. We don't spam on the newsletter. We just send conference infos. And yeah, it's going to be 10 years. Like, the first PyData Berlin was actually in 2014, and it was my first PyData conference as well. So, and it was at the BCC as well. So, really happy to join you. So, I'd like to introduce you to Hanzo. Hello.
Hi.
Staying here. So, I think the cameras are moving. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, the camera.
Okay. Right. Hi. Welcome to the PyData BBQ. My name is Jansu Chak, and I've been working for the Technologie Park here in Heidelberg since March. Before that, I was a scientist in a hospital working on a software. It was an AI software, and we had great technical expertise, and we had the potential to build a great company. But we had no idea how to get invests, we had no idea how to get customers, and we had no idea how to build and manage a company. So if we only had known about the KI Garage. Well, now I know it, and I'm here to tell you a little bit about that. The KI Garage is a program of the Baden-Württemberg Stiftung. We have two accelerator programs. One of that is the network accelerator. It will take place in October again. And if you want to apply, you can do that with that QR code. The network accelerator is a program for early stage AI startups or for people who want to, or scientists who want to build a startup. And if you have any question, feel free to contact me here today. So I'm here, and have a great afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry. So, next is PyLady Südwest. Hola.
Do you want to
continue? Oh, yes.
Go ahead.
All right. Okay, welcome, Hanzo.
Yeah, again.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah.
Hello again. My name is Jansu Chak, and I went to the PyCon last year and met all of the PyLadies. Yeah. And I get known about the PyLadies Karlsruhe, and we thought about it to bring PyLadies to Heidelberg, and then it was the same like the PyData. We said, why Heidelberg? Why Karlsruhe? So now we start the PyLadies Südwest. And I don't know what to tell more about. It's more about diversity, not about ladies. Oh, yeah, we have the next meetup. It's crazy. I'm organizing it. So the next meetup is in October. And join us. Just join us. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, no, the cameras. Oh, okay, come on, camera. So, yes. Yes. Camera. Yeah. Camera. I got camera. You got me, right? Okay, so I think that's one of the last slides before we start with Ines' talk. So if you want to give a talk, yeah, we have a lightning talk. Yeah, share your expertise with the community. Community's give and take. There's a web form. Just throw out ideas at us. We're very happy to help. You can start with just like 5-minute lightning talks. Maybe today we have a slot free. I probably have mentioned that. And our meetup is a safe space. So you talk about what you've learned, what you want to share, and yeah, also organizers, we are happy to mentor and help you. Like if you're a first-time speaker, just reach out to us. And next is Slido, if you want to ask question. The link is also on the Meetup webpage, or you can go to Slido and ask questions. So the speakers. And now I would like to welcome Ines Montani. So, and you don't have a microphone yet. So I'll give you just my microphone.
Okay.
Oops, no, that's my phone, so sorry. Yes.
Okay.
Oh, here you go.
Where do I click this?
Yeah, you can just.
Well, I don't have pockets.
Okay.
No problem. Oh, I pressed a button. Is that bad?
No, no, it's not bad. It's just like the clip. Sorry.
Well, I'm just trying to clip it to my pants.
May I help?
Yeah.
Yes.
Sorry.
It's the other way around.
Ah, yeah.
So, okay. Are you all set up? Two, one.
So. Yeah?
Yeah?
Good?
Yeah?
Okay.
Wunderbar. So, dann.
Hab das vor.
Einfach. Hier den anschließen.
Den hier. Strom.
Den brauchen wir gar nicht. Nee, Strom ist hier.
Ja, aber ich habe hier keinen.
Achso,
dann. Weißt du, was hast du nur für einen komischen Dings, dass du Strom auf der anderen Seite hast?
Schalt, das ist der andere.
Ah.
Aber hier Strom, das andere ist nur Internet.
Ah, okay.
Genau, und jetzt müsste es HDMI Gods be with us.
Nee. Warte, ging doch eben.
Ja.
Oder so.
Machen wir mal rein. Ja, ja, die verhandeln. Ja, es tut sich was, tut sich was. Yes! Ja, und Strom können wir jetzt auch wieder reinstecken, oder? Weil das ist nur Strom. Da kann nichts passieren. Ja!
Yeah.
So, warte. Moment. We don't have the projector. No, it should work.
Okay. Ah, shit. Ah, I unclipped it again.
Yes. Ooh, so nice. We're back, and you have to basically set the camera like this. Like
that's right. You.
L, like an L. Just like you have to just do this. No, just one hand, like.
Ah!
Now,
wow! It's.
Move a bit. Yes. Now you have.
Wow.
The camera vision. Follow you. Yeah. So please give a warm welcome to Ina.
Yeah. Yeah, hi everyone. Also, I'm really sorry for being late. I just heard I'm the reason that everything's delayed because I took too long scooting with the e-scooter over like the bridge and like looking at Heidelberg on the way because it's my first time in Heidelberg. And interestingly, the city still always had a very special place in my heart because it's where my parents met back in the 80s, I think, when my mom was studying Spanish at the University of Heidelberg, and my dad went to hotel school. So, yeah,
so
always.
Without Heidelberg, no Ines. Right?
Yeah, exactly. Without Heidelberg, I wouldn't exist. So, it's definitely a very special PyData, and I've always wanted to visit. So, I'm really happy to be here. And so I will talk about large language models, which is a topic on everyone's mind, and maybe is this working? A quick intro. Some of you might know me for my work on spaCy, which is an open source library for natural language processing in Python. We've been very lucky to have a lot of users, and we have been around for a long time. People seem to have liked the library. It's been downloaded over 160 million times, and spaCy really focuses on real-world use cases and building pipelines that can be used in production. And it was designed like that from pretty much day one. And we've put a lot of work, maybe some people might say too much work, in really ensuring stability, not breaking backwards compatibility. But a really nice effect of that is that there's a lot of spaCy code out there. The actual usage hasn't changed that much. And that means that ChatGPT is actually really good at writing spaCy code, which is kind of like another meta level. Like instead of using ChatGPT to do things for you, you could use ChatGPT to generate rules that let spaCy do something for you much faster and more efficiently. So that's all really cool. And another thing we do at Explosion is Prodigy, which is a modern annotation tool that's fully scriptable in Python and really helps developers create training data, create evaluation data for machine learning models, especially for any structured task, which is incredibly common in real-world applications. And Prodigy is also been quite popular. We currently have over 8,000 users, probably even more. And yeah, it's also similar to spaCy. It's also really designed from the ground up to be used in real projects and also be used as a tool that fits neatly into your workflow powered by Python, which makes it really easy to extend any library. And currently, we have been working on an extension that takes Prodigy into the cloud together with spaCy while also ensuring data privacy, scriptability. That's currently in beta. If that's something you're interested in, like creating data, working with data, really going end-to-end from an idea to a trained model, you can also talk to me about that because, yeah, we're ready to roll out our first big product soon. And, we can see some of the Python that goes into Prodigy. And, with all that in mind, before we kind of go deeper into, you know, large language models, what can they do, what does it all mean, I think this is a really important distinction that we kind of need to, you know, make clear from the get-go, and that's the difference between generative and predictive tasks. So large language models, GPT, whatever, these models have introduced like a lot of new capabilities, especially on the generative side, which is stuff like summarization, reasoning, problem solving, paraphrasing, style transfer, question answering. And these are all really cool and super important, and also things that are things we couldn't so easily do on that level before. And then on the other hand, there are also tasks that where the output is not text to text, but where the output is more something that's machine readable instead of human readable. And that's what I call predictive tasks. And that's stuff like text classification, entity recognition, relation extraction, coreference resolution, grammar, morphology, semantic parsing, discourse structure, everything where the output is some kind of structured format. And I don't have any exact statistics on that, but I would say that the absolute majority of all machine learning systems, NLP systems that are currently in use and especially already providing value are more on the predictive side, because it's often, you know, often the output needs to be consumed by something else, feeds into some other process. And this is also an area where, you know, larger models can help a lot, and they're surprisingly good at it, but also not as good yet as you might think from scrolling through your LinkedIn feed or talking to ChatGPT. So there's also still, you know, a lot of room for improvement. And I also want to talk about, kind of a vision that goes beyond like, hey, let's just, you know, talk to some bot, because we think that, hey, that's not ambitious enough. You know, we can do so much. We can go further than that. But basically, generative and predictive, that's a distinction. And also, of course, a lot of the software we've been working on, it's really more on the predictive side, because there's a lot of really interesting stuff you can do there. So, the distinction again, human readable, machine readable. And if we're looking at what can these new models that we all have access to and that have these new capabilities, like what does it mean for the future? How does it all fit in? And what will it say about like our life and our work in say 5 to 10 years? One thing I always like to do is kind of go back and look at the history of how people thought about technology of the future, and exact cases where we know the answer, and maybe what we can learn from that and how we can use that to shape how we are thinking about the future. And my absolute favorite that I've already showed, I think, in many talks, so sorry if you've seen this before, are these postcards from the World Exhibition in 1900. And these show how people imagined the year 2000. And I think it's like, there are more of these. I love looking at them. It's like super interesting. And what you can really see here is that, like, yes, people try to solve problems that we have also solved, but also in inherently human-shaped ways, or by solving, very directly solving the way these things were dealt with before, like this like scrubbing robot, or like this very physics-defying flying firefighter force that, like, I don't know, does not consider water pressure. But, we have solved all of these things, and some of them actually this vision there for video calls was actually relatively accurate. But we also went a step further, and we didn't just take the problem and translated it one-to-one into a technical solution. especially, you know, for the firefighting. Yes, we might have, you know, built better fire trucks, but we also built smoke alarms, and we even built, we use better materials to build buildings that are not wood to prevent these fires in the first place. So, you know, it goes a lot further than that. And similarly, you know, even if we're looking at like, you know, direct computers and technology replacing human labor, one thing we see here is, yep, we have a whole room of people adding up things and calculating sums, and we can replace all of that with a calculator. And again, also one of my absolute favorites, up to the 1950s, the job of a knocker-upper existed, and those were people hired with to walk around with a stick, knock on people's windows so they would wake up in time for work when alarm clocks weren't reliable enough. And you know, yes, we have replaced this with technology, with better alarm clocks, with phones that we now have in our pockets. But I think this is also a great example. We did not replace knocker-uppers with a window knocking machine. And I think this is always a very important test if you're thinking about like, hey, how can I use technology to solve a problem? Am I building the alarm clock and really solving the problem in the most efficient way for the human? Or am I building a window knocking machine that literally translates what a human does into technology? And we can actually see an example of this in the more recent past in the first kind of chatbot hype where people imagined, hey, we can finally build something that kind of works. Let's try and mimic exactly what a human does and translate that into a chatbot so you can talk to a bot to book your meetings. And a lot of that didn't work so well because it turned out that there are actually much better ways to use technology to solve that problem. And one of those is Calendly, which I love for scheduling. You send someone a link and they can book something. That's much better than talking to a bot version of a human going back and forth on time zones. Or even using NLP and using language understanding in a slightly different way by, say, letting you write natural language descriptions of your appointments that are then automatically added to your calendar. And I think we also have a similar similar questions that we have to ask ourselves when we look at, hey, we have these large models that can do pretty impressive things and really add a lot of new capabilities. What does that mean? How will the future look like? And what's kind of the equivalent of, say, a window knocking machine versus an alarm clock? And when we look at NLP, natural language processing, in the age of large language models like GPT-4, ChatGPT, they're kind of two different, they're kind of off in a lot of ways polar visions of how you know, the future could look. And one of those is on this spectrum of, on the one side, structured data is still gonna be really important, SQL, whatever, databases, that's all you need, and that's gonna kind of stay that way. And on the other end, you have a take that's more like, hey, dialogue is all you need. All problems are gonna be you know, solved by talking to a bot in a dialogue form, and we can cut out the whole database thing altogether. And similarly, on another axis, we have the you know, the one end of the spectrum. Well, we still need a lot of humans that can create data, that can work with the system, and you know, really build these applications. And on the other end, you have a take that we also sometimes see that's, well, ultimately, it's all going to be about prompting. That's, you know, the future, you know, is, yeah, we prompt a model, we're not going to actually interact with it in any other way. And those are kind of the questions. And one, given that we've talked about, you know, generative and predictive tasks, here I wanted to show you like a very classic NLP problem that we see all the time that comes up in pretty much any industry. And that's also something kind of fundamental that, like, us humans, we've done before computers manually, and then we've been doing it with computers, and now we're trying to do it with better and better machine learning models. And that's extracting structured data from unstructured text. So, you know, here we have a text about a fundraising announcement, and of course, these come in any kind of natural language, and what we want to find out is who invested in which company, how much money and so on, put that in a database so we can later calculate stuff. So ultimately, what we really have to do here is we have to first, we have to extract these companies, we have to disambiguate them, so like map them to an entry in a knowledge base, make sure that it's that Apple, that Huli, and so on that we're talking about. We need to look it up in some custom database, like whether it's Crunchbase or some internal thing that like we've been curating for decades. And also currency, we need to extract that. After we've extracted that, we need to normalize that into like an integer that we can do maths with. And we also need to extract relations. So that's you know, a very classic problem, and there are different ways to solve that. Like, you know, there is, you know, you can sometimes do some of these things quite well by just prompting a large language model. You can build it the old school way. But this is really the thing that we're trying to solve. And if we can do that better, that's kind of one of the things that has the biggest value in like a lot of real world applications. And, you know, we're going back here, we're kind of strongly, we're on the predictive side. And one thing, you know, we can see here is, well, we can, you know, take something like GPT-4 out of the box, ask it to give us all of that information. Then it gives us back text because, you know, it's generative. We're going back, you know, trying to extract all the information out of it. That works quite well. But also, what if, you know, what if we kind of want more of this? And also, given that this is kind of my terminology slide as well, don't have this specifically on the slide, but I think one other important distinction is, what are we even calling a large language model? Like, unfortunately, right, especially at the moment, the terminology in, I don't know, the field in or in the world in general is incredibly vague. And there's also, you know, some PR speak involved. And, you know, this, so you can, you find people calling every fine-tuned BERT model that companies have had in production for like years a large language model now, which is maybe technically correct, but also technically not. So there is like, you know, there is this distinction here. I'm mostly using LLM to mean like a model that does in-context learning, and I'm getting to that later, but, you know, we're not talking about stuff we've already had for, you know, a long time. But one thing that's actually kind of interesting and surprising is that at the moment, out of the box, large language models don't necessarily do that well on structured prediction tasks, at least not as well as you might think. So here are some, you know, benchmarks we ran, and you can see, you know, the accuracy of and the accuracy on, you know, the percent of examples that we used. So we basically, you know, compared what if we sort of train like a BERT-sized model and compare that against like you know, just the zero-shot output that we get. And first one we did, that was a sentiment data set. That's a really relatively easy problem, you know, predicting sentiment. And here what we can see is, well, you know, almost 95% out of the box. That's really good. It's a simple problem. And here, still, we do need to use 50% of the examples that we have if we're really training a model on labeled examples where we know the answer to get to that baseline. But again, it's still, you know, we can still beat that with only, you know, 50%. Of the training set. So next one is slightly harder, but still pretty standard news data set predicting categories over news. And here we see that actually the baseline starts pretty low. I mean, 85%, pretty good. We wouldn't have been able to do that so easily years ago. But even with 1% of the training data, we can beat that by 5%. So if we just take 1% of labeled examples, train a model with it, we have something that's much smaller and also much faster, private, and better. So that was like pretty exciting. So it's like, okay, can we do this even more? And here's an even harder data set, which is about banking. So lots of specific terminology, baseline. Still, again, 70% is not bad, but it's also quite low. We want better than that. And here again, with you know, even, you know, with 5% of examples, we can beat that significantly, and it even keeps going up. So if we use the whole training set, or even just 50% of it, we can get significantly better accuracy. So that's all pretty motivating. So, you know, if we know exactly what we're trying to do, like predict categories, we can we can build something that's better pretty easily. And another nice example here is this is on named entity recognition. So extracting spans of texts like person, organization from unstructured data. So here, what we can see is that that's the current state of the art, unless something came up recently, which I don't think it did. So this is on few shot prompting. If we just take GPT-4, GPT-3.5, we get pretty good accuracy out of the box on this benchmark data set. Also, still lower than what's out there and easy to use, and also still lower, interestingly, than the state of the art in 2003, which is when that data set was released. And granted, this is just like, this is one benchmark data set that's not even that great. And also, we shouldn't discount that the big advantage here is that, like, hey, we can get to 83% accuracy without doing anything. But we can also get much higher. And I think that's kind of where, the interesting part is, if we can get a lot of nice things out of the box, how much further can we bring this? And again here, the important distinction, whether we call it LLM or however we call it, is that these large models, they use in-context learning. So they know a lot and a lot about what the text means, but they don't really know what you want it to do, which is, which makes a lot of sense. And then on the other side, we have what I'm calling task-specific models, which for some reason also some people call LLMs, which makes the whole thing really confusing. And here we're really talking about fine-tuning something like BERT for a very specific task. If we know what we want, we can take advantage of that. So here, a model obviously knows a lot less about what the text means because it's smaller, but we can use to our advantage that we can encode exactly what we want it to do in the model. And that means that we can actually use this during development, and we can take this large language model, take everything that's in it that's good and useful, and then use that to develop a task-specific model that has a lot of advantages. It's smaller, faster, better, and we can really, as we've seen, even on some pretty basic experiments, we can beat the accuracy, and I'm sure with better larger language models and better techniques, we can take this even further and make this even more efficient. So what we, as the developer, have to do here is prompt engineering. We have to still think about how do we define the problem. That's not, that's not going to go away magically if, we still have to decide what we even want to do and why and how. We have to create some data. We can use the large language model to do that, but we still have to, make sure that our data is good, because otherwise we can't fine-tune a model that's like this good. And we, of course, need to train it and evaluate it. Evaluation we need to do in any case, because we need to know how good our system is and if it improves. And, it's easy to have a system that's 100% accurate if your evaluation is shit. But that's not the point. We want to build something that's actually good. And then this task-specific model is something we can actually ship to production. And it's something we own, runs, can be under 1 gigabyte, and it just can run fast, efficient, as we've also seen previously in the benchmarks. Any task-specific model will be significantly faster than any API. We don't have to worry about latency. We can just ship it. And so what I'm basically saying is, if we go back to our axes here, I see modern, practical NLP pretty much in the middle of this. We still want structured data. There are a lot of use cases and problems where, kind of replacing that with a dialogue would be the equivalent of a window knocking machine. Like, we still, structured data has its place and it's good for a lot of things. We still need humans in the loop. We need high quality data. We need to evaluate whether what we're doing makes sense and has the right purpose. And often the end consumer of this are humans. So we need subject matter experts who can actually validate what we're doing. But the prompting and dialogue-based generative models do give us very fast prototyping. So we, instead of having to collect hundreds of examples, or putting in 40 hours before we get kind of a shit model we can improve, we can now start off with like a pretty decent or even kind of shit model that we can improve and use you know, the LLMs or the prompting at development time to build a system that's even better than what we could do before. And I also think it's going to be powered by open source, of course, on the code side, but also a lot of the work, and especially in academia, is also still happening in the commons and is public. And I do think open source technologies, open source tooling, and of course Python will play a big role in that. And we also need a mix of conversational and graphical interfaces. Like, just because you can talk to this model in a conversational style doesn't mean that a conversational UI is like the best solution for everything. Again, window knocking machines versus alarm clocks. So in a lot of cases, a graphical UI where you can click a button or select a meeting you want to book or do whatever, if you're an analyst looking at a list of things you can filter, is better than having to talk to a bot. So I think, none of this graphical interfaces are not going away. And that means we also need structured data and we need to approach this in a more holistic way. So in practice, I'll give you like a very quick, I know, I've started late, so of course I'm late. But I want to give you a little example of what this looks like in practice, what you can already use now, and also, of course, a little snapshot of what we've been developing. So what we really see as incredibly important in this is a large language model powered collaborative data development platform and environment that developers can work on, subject matter experts can work on, and where you can use the LLMs to create labeled data that you can then use to train better models. And that means if you want to train these better task-specific models, that data needs to be good. Transfer learning has this great advantage that we can train really good models with good embeddings and very few examples, but that actually makes these very few examples more valuable, not less. So these need to be really good, but with good tooling, we can do that. And we also want to tune prompts and compare the models in an empirical way. And there's like a lot of cool work happening in that. We also have been doing some of that internally. Like a lot of the things people do are mostly trial and error and just like trying something out and saying, this feels slightly better. But you want to have an easy way to just see what works best. And with all of that, you can build data sets and actually train and also evaluate more efficient production-ready pipelines that really solve the problem that you have and come with all the other advantages. So here's an example actually of some of the workflows we've built in our annotation tool Prodigy, but something similar works. If you can even build something like that yourself on the command line in just Python. And what we're doing here is we ask the OpenAI API for predictions on this text, given these labels, and then we highlight those spans in the text. All the model has seen are the labels, now also optional label descriptions and the text. And then it tries to give us these spans. What we can see is there are some mistakes. It will always inevitably make mistakes, especially it can be quite inconsistent and also non-deterministic. So, you might do the same thing tomorrow and it gives you different predictions, which kind of sucks. But you can correct these mistakes, and submit it. So that's all very easy. And you can also add correct answers to the prompt to tune it. If you have like specific things where you feel like, hey, the model keeps making mistakes, or it's something weird in my domain, you can include it in the prompt and hopefully get better predictions, or not, and then you kind of have to go back and include more examples. And under the hood there, one of the hard parts is that a generative model is generative, and so the output is text. So we feed it a text, and we want structured data out of it, but what it gives us back is a text. So there's actually a lot of work going into like how can we write better prompts to achieve that and make it output something that like then lets us turn it back into structured annotations on the data, because again, it will just reply with this string, location, colon, London, Berlin, and then we kind of have to go and map that back in a text so we can say, hey, this character to this character, that's what we're interested in, because we really want to usually map it back into our original data. And for that, we have built an extension to spaCy, which is called spaCy LLM, and it does take care of all of that, the prompting under the hood. In a way, it works quite similarly to what spaCy does if you've used it before, because our vision has always been, we want to build one named entity recognition component that just works and does the thing. You don't have to choose between lots of algorithms. It just works. And here we kind of trying to do the same thing with the prompting, and what you get back is a doc object that works just like any other spaCy doc object, whether you use a machine learning model, whether you use rules, or whether you use any large language model, whether it's an API, but also an open source model you host yourself, someone else hosts under the hood. So you can easily swap that out and compare the results as well, evaluate, get a score, know what baseline you have to beat, and then take it from there. And so, yep, currently these are components that we have, including really cool stuff that actually was a lot harder to do previously with just a machine learning model, like relation extraction. That can work quite well, so we've been trying this out, and that's actually quite exciting, but also even for more classic linguistic tasks like lemmatization. That's also still incredibly important in a lot of applications, not as sexy as a lot of other things, but still pretty important, and you can use under the hood either a large language model, a supervised model, or rules, and you can mix and match these as well in a pipeline, so you can have one component powered by that, one component powered by that, and that's kind of the concept of it, and it's under very active development. We've been continuously adding features, and we think this could really be a big part in that vision that we have that allows people to build these kind of superior models, basically. So to wrap this up and have barbecue, my main point that I'm trying to make here is that easier isn't ambitious enough. Yes, a lot of advantages of just writing a prompt are that it's easy and helps people get started, and that's great. And I think this will have a huge positive impact on our field. But we also want to think beyond just, hey, let's put some API in our system and call it a day. We don't want to build stuff that's actually worse than what we're currently building. And the quality of the systems, machine learning systems that are in production today is high. And we shouldn't underestimate that. So we don't want to build systems and things that are worse just because, oh, it's a bit easier, or maybe it's a bit cheaper, or maybe not. So my main goal, or my main message, is be more ambitious. And that's because, well, often being specific is better. If you know what you want, you can build systems that do exactly what you want to do. And last time I gave this talk in a slightly modified version, I got a question asking me about like Skynet and like, oh, apocalypse, and like, oh, if I believe in like machines taking over and the whole doomer argument. And actually, even aside from anything I said in this talk today, if you are worried about like all the doomer outcomes, you should also care about this, because if you train a task-specific fine-tuned bird, this is never going to take over the world. Like, this is going to predict one out of five labels, and no matter what you give it, it's never going to be able to do something evil. Like, I'm not a doomer, but like, if you meet doomers, this is also the message for you. And also, smaller and faster is better. There's so many, we don't need to run a thing. Like, we have good systems in production. We don't need to replace them with like an API that runs at 100 words per second. Like, there are a lot of cases where we want something small, and we want something fast, and we want something that we can maybe run on a phone, on one single GPU, on your laptop, even if it's not the latest M2 MacBook. And there's absolutely a case for that. And why would we not do that if we can? Like, if we can make models bigger, we can also make them smaller while making them just as good and much better at the very specific task that we know we want. And private is also better. Like, we don't have to send our data to some random API in some random country or some random startup and we shouldn't have to settle for that. We can run things ourselves, whether you know we care about data privacy, whether we're forced to do this by law or not. Private data privacy is good, and I think that's another great advantage. And finally, better is always better. Like, we want to train systems that are better than what we have, not worse. There are a lot of cases where, it's always going to be a race to the top. We don't want a fraud detection system that's, like, surprisingly good given it hasn't been trained. Like, it needs to be, like, really good and better than anything else. And there are tons of these use cases. So I think we should aim higher than just, meh, it's, pretty good and convenient. And I think there's a lot to be done. There's also a lot we're working on, and I think we can be more ambitious. And yeah, I'm very excited to see what the future holds. Thanks.
Are we doing questions now?
Yes. Schon mal? Switch on.
Test us? Yes.
All right, we do have a few minutes for questions, only a few, because barbecue is waiting already.
But we can do barbecue and people can just, I don't wanna want people to sit here like,
We'll do a quick one, okay?
Okay.
So you can ask a question on Slido or here in the room. If you want to ask a question here in the room, just raise your hand and I'll forward you the microphone and I'll do my best with my climbing abilities here. Okay, any question in the room? Okay, there's one. Could you pass it straight?
Hey, thank you for the nice talk. You showed a prompt that makes... give you lines of the named entities.
Yeah.
You could maybe also have told it, hey, give me a JSON structured output and give me also all the structured data that I want. I assume you tried that and it's not great, but do you think it will always not be great?
Yeah, so this is a good question. Also, it reminded me that the prompt I have on this slide is sort of the bad prompt, like not the best prompt, not the current prompt, because we have actually, so in the latest version of spaCy, we implemented, let me go through here. I almost had it, sorry. Wait, where's my, here. That paper, which is the state of the art on few-shot prompting, and that implements a technique that is better than pretty much anything else people have tried for NER, and that's what we're implementing. I think it's not the JSON way of doing it, and I do think there are some cases where the JSON works, but also in our case there are a lot of, like, we don't need to predict like the whole structure. Like, there's a lot we can infer once we kind of know where to align it in the text. So I don't exactly know all the things we've tried, but like basically what we have implemented now is something that's better. You can, so there's a reference to the paper here. It's also in spaCy LLM. I can look at this later and then maybe give you some more background on that. But yeah, this is kind of the prompt engineering like magic, like stuff that everyone's playing around with, and it's actually, people present it like it's a science when actually I think a lot of it is just like, man, we all don't really know what's going on and people are just trying.
All right, so questions on Slido are more targeted to the panel later, so maybe another question in the room and then we'll go for barbecue.
I
shouldn't have said that, sorry, but is there another question?
A question about another layer of entity recognition, so to say, to differentiate a relation, for example, as absurd or fictitious or factual. Is there something that you think is going into that direction with the use, for example, of knowledge graphs? Or because you are already building some kind of information relations between different entities that you can actually go to a database and check, okay, is this factual or is this fictitious or is this actually absurd?
So that's a good question. And actually that also, I brought up this slide because it kind of ties into this pipeline design and really the problem, the problem of, hey, I have this thing which I want, how do I break it down into something that works best? And I think one option, it sounds like knowledge-based entity linking, something like that sounds like, that is, for example, a component you can add. So even if you do NER with like the LLM, spaCy, for example, has a knowledge-based component that you can plug in. You can also, you know, write something custom. And then there's an interesting question, if you have like mentions that you extract as spans, is that you could benchmark that against an approach where you actually just do it simpler as a text classification task. So you're like given this sentence with these entity mentions, are these absurd or something? And that is like, that's kind of a classic reimagining or breaking the task down into something that's potentially easier. And that's kind of the thing you need to try out. And that's also where we come in and say, hey, if you have, if we try to build tools that make this easier and make it easier to experiment and try out these different approaches. And
I was thinking, so the use case would be typically you are, if you're in a company, you have a customer and then he writes you something and maybe you need your model or your recommendation to actually give better recommendation, but you need to actually to ask further because maybe the customer didn't understand exactly what he was expressing in terms of business language, for example. You would ask, what's the problem? I didn't understand this problem because actually you're maybe confused. Maybe is this thing what you meant?
Yeah, or you could use maybe if you have, depending on what you predict, if that gives you confidence scores and you want to be extra sure, you could say like, okay, if my model gives me less than 80%, I need to ask the user to rephrase. Or I could use a generative model to rephrase it, ask the user back, like, is this what you meant? And then the user can say yes or no, or like there are a lot of these combinations. But again, also I think that's where like, oh, you still need to break down the problem and like reason about reason about the different flows.
Thank you.
All right. So Ines will be around for the barbecue, and I'm sure she will take all your questions there. And also she will be around for the panel later, right?
Yeah.
So I suggest we go for barbecue now, and to those watching remotely, see you later. We're about half an hour delayed, we'll start about half an hour later.
Sorry, my fault.
No, and then off panel on show. Dinner. So, welcome back. So, yep. Ja, einfach anklippen. Okay. Anklippen.
Anklippen.
Ja, einfach anklippen, genau.
Wir oben jetzt so.
Ja, ja. Genau. Und dann nehmt schon mal Platz. Ich gehe in die Mitte irgendwo.
So.
Ja, genau.
Sieht doch gute, okay. Gute Lösung, glaube ich. Ja. Hier so ein bisschen zur Seite. Ja. So, ich sag mal, ich mach das Ding kaputt.
Maybe, maybe ja, gleich habe ich.
Ja, nur muss man mit dem Haar ein bisschen aufpassen.
Weißt du, was mich voll triggert? Bei deinem Ding ist noch die
back.
Folie.
Oh. Welcome back.
Die Folie ist hier noch
welcome
dran, die kann man so
back. So, we're starting with the panel now. So, may the panelists already take their seats, please. Mm-hmm. Oh, please. So, I'm staying here. Thank you.
Oder vielleicht hier, weil ich muss dann um 10 schon besuchlich.
Okay, gut.
We are running a bit late, like half an hour. Probably don't know that. People here know that. I'm basically telling that for people who are watching remotely. So, and here now we come to the panel about LLMs. And I'm going to do an intro in a minute. But I first have to bring Alessandro in here. And now you should get the panel, yeah? So you can see Alessandro over here. And can you say something so we can hear you?
Yes, perfect.
Wonderful, wonderful. Really nice. So thank you so much for joining, man. Because I was, yeah, so, but yeah, you see, he has a scarf.
I know, I had to take the train all by myself.
Yeah. Yeah, but thanks for not bringing COVID with you as well. Yeah. Awesome. So I would like to start this round, everybody just giving a short introduction about what they do, like what the background in LLMs or like natural language processing in general is, also what the interest is, also where people stand. So let's start with remote, like Alessandro. So tell us a little bit about yourself, like 1 minute, and what's your, yeah, where you stand with natural language processing and artificial intelligence in general. Yeah.
Sounds good. Yeah, so hello everybody, my name is Alejandro. I'm currently director of engineering applied science product at Zalando, which is a European retailer. I'm also the chief scientist of ExplosionAI, which is an organization that contributes to public policy, as well as open source and development projects for responsible deployment of machine learning systems. And also contribute to other initiatives through the ACM Foundation, as well as many of the hybrid tests that Alexander actually organizes. And in terms of where I stand in the NLP side, so throughout my career, I've been working on basically like infrastructure for machine learning. But at one point in one of my previous lives, I was working on regulatory compliance automation, basically semi-structured text extraction. And that's actually where I came across through the spaCy team. Ines is a great framework, and then delved into the world of NLP. Since then, I mean, we've seen kind of like the Heidelberg growth of LLMs, and specifically to the question of where I stand. I would describe myself as skeptically excited. Because there are some really good opportunities, but maybe not what we're hearing mostly kind of on Twitter and just like that sort of doomsday narrative. Yeah. But certainly seems to be really interesting use cases, and hopefully today we can dive into some of them.
Right, thank you very much. So, Michael, you're professor at a university here. Yes. This is your home turf. This is basically your.
I'm pretty much living in the first floor.
Yes, you live. So, yes. Tell us about yourself.
Yeah, I'm here since 2008 in the Department of Computer Science. Before then, I was a professor at the University of California in Davis, California. And I'm originally a database person, then moved to data mining, scientific data management. Then we were interested in text, extracting data, scientific data from text, in particular geographic and temporal information, so something like named entities then in this case. And we moved more and more into text analytics, and I'm now working in that area for more, now I would say at least 10 years now, in all variety, traditional NLP, but in particular I would say I'm very much devoted to applications. So I have no project in computer science, all my projects are outside computer science. It's in the legal domain, it's in the medical domain, it's with economics, so all over the place where they have lots of text, and I think especially the legal domain and finance domain, for example, economics, it's quite interesting and challenging here in this case. And from that point I can say most of the approaches I've seen so far, off-the-shelf language models and tools, they don't work in these areas, right? So there's a lot of stuff to that where you have to do fine-tuning, adjusting, getting proper evaluation metrics and so on. But it's exciting, but I personally also find it frustrating because for me it's hard to keep an overview. So I'm sitting half an hour a day on LinkedIn and basically following some people and see what's going on. And that's a frustrating thing for me from an academic side, right, that you are not aware of where you are.
Have you ever considered a large language model reading the papers for you? No, I'm kidding. No, I think like, who feels like there's so much new stuff like out every day, which is amazing, but you can never basically follow or even try it out. Just raise your hand who feels like that. You see like everybody, yeah, many people in this room feel so, we feel the same. So, Alina, like.
Yeah, so hi everybody, my name is Alina Lenhardt, happy to be here. I'm my educational background is in computational linguistics, so I have a master's degree from the University of Tübingen, and I've been working as a computational linguist in translation and in automotive industry. So I've been working for 5 years at Cerence, which is a conversational AI company in the automotive domain. We're developing speech assistants for cars, motorcycles, and other applications in the mobility domain. And I'm in text-to-speech team, working on text normalization, language identification problems, and in academia, I had projects also in text classification and anaphora and coreference resolution. So today I would be sharing my view on how it would go, how it would work in production, the LLMs. And there I stand with Ines. So the tools that you have, it depends on your requirements and what you would like to achieve. So LLM is not the only answer to the solutions.
Yeah, I had no idea you went to Tübingen University. We have like several people on our team.
Great.
And there's a small town near Tübingen that has like the highest number of Explosion members per capita because it's like, two.
Let's see. I mean, I told you in the slides in the opening, stuff is happening here, and good stuff is happening down here in the south. And the weather is better anyway. But apart from that, I collected some questions from up front, and I would like to start with Ines, because like Ines, you've always been a supporter for open source. And at the time when there was like, hey, cloud services, models, you just throw text at models you never seen, and you always said, no, this is not the future. Stacy is open source, so and have LLMs changed anything?
One of the like yes and one no mostly. back then, really, the idea was, well, you know, you always have to, if you think commercially, there has to be, people had this idea of like, oh, let's lock away our algorithms, let's lock away our models. And of course that can't, really win because all the work happens in academia, in the commons, and it's always public. But I think one of the reasons I think cloud APIs only get us so far is that doing the predictions is very rarely the end of what you're doing. Like it's usually like one part of your system and you want to do more with those predictions and you want to load them back into some structured format, compute with them. do stuff with them. And so, you know, it's very limiting, like, you know, having a REST API and then trying to translate that to something in Python can be quite limiting. Mm-hmm. And of course, there are also other questions around data privacy, sending stuff to an API. You also don't know what's behind that, like, you know.
So you basically say you need to be in control of your data, and that's why it's never being going.
Yeah, and also you kind of want to
somebody else.
You need to program with the model as well, like it's a part of the system. And so I think it's the same. Now, sure, you have scaling effects of like these very large models, and it's it's not economical to run that yourself. But I do think that's
many people who use ChatGTP think it can do anything, and they're not aware it's not working for their domain. It's
working
for
general
stuff, and
it works differently tomorrow because you don't control the model. So it's
So Alejandro, so are LLMs dominating Zalando already, or?
I think my perspective would be basically echoing what Ines just said, that it's only dominating the coffee chats, right? When it comes to the actual production, this is where I do want to bring kind of like an interesting two-faced perspective on this. So on one is basically some of the applications of LLMs in Zalando, which I think people here will find quite interesting. But also the second part, which is what LLMs have actually changed generally, including also Zalando. And I think, as Ines pointed out, I think what it has changed is, in a way, it has accelerated the discourse on basically the questions around best practices for MLOps, for complex machine learning models, right? How do you approach basically serving these models in an efficient manner, but also how do you introduce, from an architectural perspective, ways of managing these models in actual real-life applications, including things like data quality, including things like monitoring, as well as basically understanding what are kind of like undesired or unintended effects of putting that out there. And what I have been seeing is that LLMs have kind of like taken the world by storm more in the prototyping space, right? Like actually trying to get an idea fast, and especially get an idea fast in the machine learning side, right? People are actually building like even, I don't know, sentiment classifiers by providing some like prompts that would get you at least to get something out quite fast. But the challenge when it comes to LLMs is to get to that, to get from that 90% to the 100%. And I think especially in large organizations and large user bases, you can't just put in production at 90%, right? Because that 10% may end up with impact to both the organization, the brand, etc., that you just cannot afford. And I think that is the uncertainty that we still haven't been able to address. And for that first point, in terms of like what are some use cases, I think the most recent one that was actually actually published was this fashion assistant, right? Like, I'll tell you what I like to wear, recommend me some clothes. But I think right now the current challenge is that last 10% that has been really dangerous. But I think the operations of LLMs, which a lot that we can talk about, but
yeah, I think that's a pretty interesting take. You say it's the prototyping stuff, because there's also like a lot of stuff going on. Music with AI, which addresses the same thing. And just yesterday, there was a really nice article in MIT Technology Review that said actually like for the new Star Wars series, the producer considered, hey, I want Hans Zimmer. So they asked the startup, can you do a Hans Zimmer soundtrack? And when they listened to it, they said, yeah, that's sounds like, that's cool, but it's just like a 7 of 10. And if you hire Hans Zimmer for a soundtrack, you hire him for 10 and not the 7. Yeah. And I think that was a very good, another take on what
lot of models can do, but also it's challenging. So yeah.
Sorry, I don't want to take over the conversation. Actually, this was like he brought up like a really good point that I also tried to make before and maybe didn't make so well. Of like, hey, what delivers the value? It's like, hey, and you know, what really matters? Like, hey, the fashion assistant, Zalando is cool. Like, I don't know, maybe I would use it for fun. Maybe it drives some more people to buy one more pair of shoes. But like, what really, you know, if that is 5% more accurate, does Zalando make more money? Probably not. But if the recommendation system or like some more old, like, you know, some of the bread and butter is like 1% more accurate, that's like 10 million plus. Right? Like that's the sort of, at least the message I get from companies.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think that the interesting thing is actually when we start looking at use cases of LLMs, not as the chatbots themselves, but as components and cogs in the system. And I think this is the second part, and I think we can dive into it, but the other part that actually like LLMs are opening up in this course of operationalization is basically, let's call it data-centric architectures for machine learning models, right? Where you have actually multiple nodes in your machine learning system, where a lot of the MMM world is starting to call it basically like agent chain architectures. But beyond the LLMs, you have just basically ML systems, right? Which just the LLMs is one small component. I think it's what you're saying, Ines, that like the real value is the whole machinery. So, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but also, like, we have challenges because, Michael, you had, like, when we talked before, said, hey, how can you keep up with that in your studies? I mean, there's always so many new things. Also, like, a technological challenge, because you say, hey, please put this LLM on your laptop. JetGTP API is probably not good enough. So that's a challenge. Are there any solutions, or is it something we should, ideas, how can the community help for this thing, or is it basically?
So what I find interesting, a part of the direction is really this fine tuning, the different types of fine tuning you have. For example, this LoRA approximation and QR quantization models and these things. I think this is a cool direction than in this case, right? So I don't think it makes much sense to train larger and larger models than in this case, but to focus on how do we reduce the size of these models and keep their quality, right? And it's like knowledge distillation in a very, very similar direction in this case, but also have a much closer look at the data. And I think that's what everybody seems to be missing. They don't look at the data. Right. If you have poor quality data, what do you expect then in this case? And would people spend more time looking at the data and even many benchmarks that are out there? If you look at their quality in terms of duplicates data, incomplete data, and so on and so on, and then there are fine-tuning a model on poor quality data. True, in reality, I think you also have poor quality data, but I think it's time worth spent on improving the quality, curating the data, and then having a stable, good model than in this case. So these are the two areas where I think still of stuff can be done that on the data side and on the optimization side, not training larger models in this case. In particular, I'm not a big fan of these prompt engineering hype stuff at the moment, right? So for those of you who know adventures, these text adventures in the 80s, okay.
That's a really good one.
This was some kind of prompting. Yeah. Go left, open the door, right? pick the shovel, etc. Right? So it goes in that direction. Yeah. Nobody can explain it quite in a way, right? It's all statistics eventually, but it's very hard to teach. Okay. If we have to do this in school at the university, how do you teach about prompting, right? With these 50 pages and here's another good 3 prompts, and so there's no real scientific approach to this, I think.
Actually, is there?
Linguistics. I think definitely send people to linguistics class because you need to understand how language works.
But for example, if you have to explain, if you change the wording a little bit, you get a completely different. Because one of the 175 billion parameters now add another. That's not something satisfying to me at least. Yeah, right? It might work, but it's not satisfying from the scientific.
Yeah. Also, tomorrow actually I'm on a full day workshop with lawyers, and I ask them. just like, of course, because like I like to use ChatGPT just for inspiration. Hey, just throw me some ideas. And then I said, as a coach, what should I ask like lawyers about LLMs? And then LLMs was actually like a master of legitimate something because it was lawyers was very close. So it was not large language models, for example. So you change a bit and stuff. So is prompting actually a real thing, or is that just like people made up, yeah, you need to learn prompting? I mean, is there like a logic, or is it more try and error and people explain it's try and error?
But I mean, there are like some techniques. So one thing at actually PyData Amsterdam, my colleague gave a talk on, like, you can find it online, I think soon, and there's like materials from tournaments. There's like, you know, it's a more empirical, like he, I think, developed like some, you know, something similar to like an ELO rating for, you know, comparing prompts, and you can do something like that, but people, then again, that's too close to, oh, eat your vegetables, look at your data.
It's not stable. If you again modify your model a little bit, and so you can throw away everything.
But even then people are like,
oh,
but that's work, that's and then true, I have to look at the data, and it's like, you know, and I think people overestimate also the work it takes. It's maybe, you know, it says, oh, but it's like, honestly, I mean, you're going to spend more time on waiting for ChatGPT to return the results, given the latency, than you would like actually just look at your data.
Yeah, really cool, because also one of the questions I reached out to some experts, and VB actually asked, how do you think on productionizing large models for like smaller applications? But I think, use proper data, use good
data. Or it's like if you're only using them for development time, that also changes a lot of the calculations. If you can find an approach where you use them for development to create better data, to just generate stuff you can work with and not in production. If you can train something much smaller, then you also have fewer of the problems you have. If you're thinking of like, oh, how do I productionize a billion parameter model? Yeah, sucks for you, then probably an API provider does it better.
So Alina, what are the challenges? I mean, you work at a company, that you have like expert, like already fine-tuned working systems, like for like special as you said, I wasn't aware of motorcycles, actually, that there's a...
It's coming, yeah.
It's coming, but it's really, that's cool. So, yeah, but what are the challenges? And, oh, my God, we have to change this, will this be a shift? Or no, let's ignore that, because we can never put it in the hardware anywhere. So what is the situation?
Basically... for me, like the NLP evolution is like happening, like when I basically studied it, it's so fast. To me, LLM is rather one of the tools. It's not the tool to use because it really depends on the problem that you are trying to solve. For example, the what Ines presented in the slide. To identify $5 million in the text, that it's an amount of money, apparently, you might not need like a very complex model for that. You can go for rules, it's more controllable, and it's cheap, and you know for your particular domain what you encounter in your data, and that's one approach. It doesn't mean that if there is something cooler that this should be disregarded, not necessarily. So what I think still a big advantage of LLM is that you can experiment fast, you can prototype fast, we can't neglect that. And that is helping also for product teams who might not have a very in-depth knowledge of coding, deep learning, and all the coding skills that you need. You can build something based on the available APIs or models, and then just prove your hypothesis. Is what you are trying to build, is it worth? And to get feedback faster. With like no code almost, you can also generate the code for you using the same model. So that's a big thing. And also the multilingual support of the models, that's also a big advantage because in computational linguistics, everything works for English very good. And when we switch to...
it's more like the paradigm is the closer your language is to English, the better it works.
Exactly. Whoa, magic. And then you switch to
Korean, Basque, whatever. So lower source languages or languages that historically didn't have that much amount of data, simply because not that many people speak that language and not many data sources are available. Or you are working on a very specific task that is maybe a niche task in the NLP field, for example. My area was multilingual support in text-to-speech, meaning that German voice can also pronounce French city names correctly, or Italian person names, companies, things like that. Where do you find the data for that? And really compile it from scratch, that's a lot of manual work. Mm-hmm. And you can already gain at least some rather okay-ish baseline with just trying out a few prompts, seeing if it fits your task, and to have to build your baseline and prove your idea quite fast. So for that, I would like to say that it's a good thing about prompting, so that you can experiment and see what you get out of it. Obviously, the challenges, the restrictions that you have, not in because of the LLM itself, but what are the requirements for your product, the RAM requirements, CPU requirements, it's still there. It's just one of the dependencies that you're adding or you're substituting something in your stack. So, in the embedded technologies, for example, for automotive industry, you're not always having a connection to the cloud, especially if you are like in a German tunnel.
not only there.
Yeah, and there are very, very strict limitations on what you should put in the car, and because it's not, we might have a perfect dialogue, but if navigation system couldn't work because the latency is too high, that's not good. So it's still, of course, the industry, like the customers, conversational AI companies are experimenting a lot with LLMs. I cannot speak, of course, for every branch and domain. That I'm speaking about what I know, trying to fine tune, downsize the model for a specific task, etc. So that's happening, but it doesn't mean that the technology that you had before, you really have to get rid of it. It depends on what you're trying to improve, which methods don't work for your task good enough, and then you decide which approach is better. And I like the benchmark that you've shown today that, it doesn't mean necessarily that, new model is, greatest. It's just...
And even in, some people might say, well, but it's only a matter of time. We can just make it bigger. And I'm like, well, sure. I mean, I'm sure eventually, we can have a model with more parameters that can beat, the Connell scores from 2003, of course. But at the same time, if we can do that, we can also make even better, smaller models. Mm-hmm. Why would that not be true? So that's kind of the logic there. But also, I think for the cars, I don't know, because I'm interested. Is it just people talking to the car and telling it to I'll turn here, do that, or turn on the music?
Turn on the music, tell me the joke,
Oh, you can have low accuracy on that, or it's more like, I think it's also this misconception. I mean, there is sort of a coded language already there, people are fine with learning, I have to say turn left and not some flowery, long-winded description of turning left, and it's that's not useful. It's turn left.
Yeah.
And again, that's do you even need fancy deep learning models for that? I mean, we had speech recognition.
way
but
before.
Like the natural language understanding remains
a big
challenge. Yeah, speaking about that, like the results should be reproducible and stable. Like if you say the same command, you expect that the output should be, we need of course some variability in the model response, but it still should matter, should match the intent. And the problem is also if there is a whole variety of answers, how do you do regression testing? How do you evaluate the model performance? Because if we need to have even more human effort to validate LLM creativity, mm-hmm. that's too much.
Yeah, that brings us to the next question. And Alessandro, can you try to speak a little? I hope it's okay for me. To speak a bit louder. We got some feedback, and I have no clue how to turn up the volume on this setup now. And this touching things. Yeah, thank you. So production and there's two questions. How can you get some thoughts on upper ops of large language models, and also what does the industry actually need?
Like, grab a water.
Sure, I'll bring you one.
Oh, thank you.
Water, anyone?
Water.
Yeah. Water.
Sorry, I'm still thirsty for my talk. I already had a beer, but it didn't really help because
you can also bring you a beer.
No, it's fine. I put it under the table. It's not. That's like antisocial to sit here. So it right. works better in German.
Go ahead.
Yeah, no, I was saying, I would love one as well.
Here you go. Oh, it would be so cool if you had a bottle now, right? That would be like awesome. Right? Yeah! Ah, that's awesome! Yeah.
Shouldn't have.
Can you just like explain pickle in one sentence to people? Well, who knows pickles?
I want maybe a show of hands. Who has used pickles in the machine learning?
Oh yeah, a lot, like 80%.
Okay,
all right. Yes.
Okay. Well, so basically, pickles are binary exports of training machine learning models, and I think that's probably kind of like a compliment. It's actually just like Python binary types, right? In a non-safe form. And ultimately, this has been kind of like now an area of discussion of how you kind of like increase security in things like this, right? There's also challenges. challenges when it comes to these things like the data itself, there's elements of like data poisoning, there's elements of management and implementation of the artifacts themselves. And it's also kind of the adversarial attack family of vulnerabilities, which is basically like the challenge of either reverse engineering the models or exploiting their capabilities. And I think this is something that we're going to start seeing more and more, just because going back to LLMs, we are starting to basically forget what we are told in the 101 of software, right? Which is basically, don't let strangers in the internet just send random commands to your computer with single access, right? And the reason why I'm doing this is because going back to the architectures that we're now starting to see in machine learning systems, like this agent machine architectures, where we basically have, let's come in this LLM that interacts with my XYZ API, right? And all the how tool I ask this LLM to book my trip in XYZ website for booking trips, right? And then, oh wow, this was great, it saved me, 1% of the time that I would save if I had done myself. But I do it because, it's cool and it's tech, right? But I think this is the sort of things that, you have to be aware, and I'm giving a very sort of like, clear, obvious example. It's like, yes, don't connect your bank account with an LLM, of course. But I think when it comes to production systems, it's much more nuanced, right? Because it's ultimately multiple hubs of different components that have different levels of capabilities and interactions with different systems, that in the chain itself, you yourself do not have full awareness of what could be a corner case that could open up a new vulnerability. Right, so I think, again, LLMs are providing much more intuitive use cases, but we are seeing this going back to that example where the LLM is finding specific small piece of the cog, or even to what is now being discussed, basically saying, hey, I use this LLM for prototyping, and now I want to just train this proper entity extraction model, right, on the data that was generated, but I want to still connect it to my entire sort of system. Now you have to take into consideration not just the security of the machine learning model, but the security of the machine learning system. But yeah, so I mean, I think there's other things when it comes to the operationalization. But I wanted to talk about security specifically. So, but yeah, I'll just pause there to see what other thoughts there are.
Yeah, what are other thoughts like LLMs, cybersecurity, European Protection Acts?
Well, I mean, I think just your data privacy. I mean, that's just something that's always been.
So actually, I think there's an important point. There's a distinction to make because it always says AI. Actually, it's the data that needs to protect me.
Well, I mean, there are also other security aspects once you have the model.
Application of data in AI models. Yes.
But even before you train any task-specific model, anything, it's like.
AI is just like an innocent network, right?
Yeah. I think it's nice to actually see that even data privacy being talked about a lot more. And like, there's still some people have this idea, it's just the Europeans with their weird data protection stuff. But it's actually like a lot of companies are like, well, no, we can't do that. We shouldn't.
I think there's many interesting approaches or like saying, hey, an AI is also like, it's a zip file of the internet.
Yeah.
There's one, I think, you said, it's also a data storage. It's not like, it's. Yeah,
well, even once you have company internal stuff, I'm like, I'm glad there are laws for it, but I don't want Zalando to take like all the info they have about me from like, I don't know, a decade of ordering and like upload that to other people's. But it's like, then again, I did not read the terms and conditions. I probably agreed to all third party vendors and whatever. My soul belongs to Zalando.
Something that for organizations is a big challenge because it's not a static risk, right? And ultimately, this risk, what it entails is that often we have data sets that in themselves may be considered private, but improvements in technology may actually result in those same data sets potentially exposed. insights and potentially even personal insight, personal insights, given the abilities to extract insights out of kind of like the larger area. So I think what the European ecosystem has done, the European ecosystem has done, is some really interesting explorations into this element of the continuously shifting dialogue of privacy, of this relationship between privacy and data, right? As privacy and data and technology advancements. Because as we see more kind of like, you know, capabilities within, whether it's LLMs or just other machine learning models, we are actually seeing even more potential risks in data sets that before we were comfortable giving, but now we're realizing that it's being used, let's say, even in some cases against us, right? And particularly we see this a lot in the ad tech type areas. So I totally agree that privacy is super key and that Europe is actually doing some really interesting explorations on that as well.
So I think it's not only privacy in this case, and I think I know a couple of companies that deal with the privacy issue by massaging the data, by curating the data. If they take medical data and they want to get something out of that, they do an anonymization and so beforehand, right? It's not after the fact. Pre-processing matters here in this case. Right? So it goes again,
yeah,
back to take care of your data, right? So it's no wonder that you have private data in your model if you didn't take care of the data that went in there. So this is definitely one point. But privacy, I don't think that privacy is such a big issue. What I hear more and more often from a consumer perspective, where now these LLMs are used in the context of chatbots, is reliability, for example. We know all about this hallucination and so on.
Oh, yeah.
And if you look closely at the EU AI Act, for example, that's the main emphasis there as well, right? The reliability, the quality of the results there in this case. And for me, this is basically something, well, how do you want to deal with it? How do you want to show that your LLM is high quality? Then in this case, you can only have a benchmark. As soon as you do some fine-tuning or so, you lose again in this case. And I think this is a tremendously big challenge if you want to convince lawmakers in the EU to make better use of these models in a variety of services, that you also come up with infrastructures to properly evaluate these LLMs in the context of particular services. I think this is a big challenge if you really are aiming at using LLMs at a larger scale and not at just companies and not just for ChatGPT on how high is the Eiffel Tower and something like that. Right?
Yeah. I think ironically, I actually have the feeling that like going forward in a lot of commercial applications, they'll actually like just put humans in front of the output again. I mean, you can't do that for online service, but if they're doing all of this fancy machine learning work, and then at the end there's like a human looking at all the outputs, so that legally there's someone to blame, and that like it fits into our frameworks, and at least until we have a better solution for it.
I think there's something that still needs to be done, right?
Yes, yeah.
As you said, the output, you must do something with this output. Yeah. Make sure
yeah. Also, like, I mean, I like to refer to Catherine Jamu's keynote in Amsterdam, because she large language models are also like a chance and for communities to train their own models, like to curate their own models, so the models actually literally speak their language and reflect what the community is about. Because currently we have these large models that basically suck all the internet in, but we of course see, of course, especially if something smaller, if it's like a smaller community, it's not reflected at all. So it's like that's the common ground, and that's dominated by larger populations or like populations that just produce more text than others. Yeah? So a fun question actually from Friedrich, and an important question to Ines.
Oh.
Where can I get that awesome NLP shirt?
It's funny, you're really not the first person to ask. There's someone asking on Twitter. I got so many questions at PyData Amsterdam. We've been thinking about it. Okay, so this was designed by like an awesome designer who's a working student, Helena, working for us, and the instructions were like, we want something custom. Like it even has the displacy visualizer here. It's basically like it's very custom. And I said,
I really want a shirt that can work in black, because all these like company shirts, they're always in colors and I don't wear colors. So I'm like, oh, I would love to wear our shirt. And so that's how this came about. It's only for the team at the moment, but there's a lot of there really is a lot of demand, and we have been joking about like, oh, what if like, I don't know, let's scrap all of this AI development and like commercial like software thing. Maybe our future revenue is just going to be in t-shirts, and that's
yeah. So yeah. So let me just scroll through.
Oh, yeah.
So what's the future of LLMs? Is it just a hype? I mean, probably where would you we stand in the Gartner hype curve? Are we at the peak and it's going to be go really down soon, or
I think it's more of a tool, like just like how other
like any other tool, and we have to learn how to do that.
And then I think there are like a lot of societal questions, and of course stuff like, hey, using these bots in like a way, like it is a technology that has really taken off in the consumer facing setup, and that is like a difference, and there's a lot probably coming from that. And
yeah, it can be a time saver.
Yeah.
So actually, if I may add a fun story, actually I sold a computer on eBay, and I thought, oh, don't sell it on eBay, because they always the buyer always wins. So it was a bare bone. There was no hard drive, there was no operating system, there was no RAM, and then the person who bought it sent me a screenshot. No, sorry, I cannot log in into my Microsoft account. I said, no, the computer obviously works, and ChatGPT gave me and I hate writing stuff like that, but I said, hey, write something friendly. And always said, oh, I'm so sorry, you cannot, computer threw in. And also then, of course, I said, oh, yeah, it's a Microsoft amount. He used an apple.me address, and I put all the information in because I knew eventually somebody from eBay support will read it, and guess what? I won. Amazing. Yeah, so it can help. It can be really useful.
I know someone who had ChatGPT help with his wedding vows.
Wedding vows? Oh,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, like this, like.
But until we notice that the wedding vows for every wedding are the same.
Yeah, well, I don't
very often
it
you get the same question.
Perhaps it does help also for the divorce.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. No, they're still very happily married.
Yeah, so. So are there any other trends? What about because we always say ChatGPT, there's Llama 2, there's a Falcon, there's a model every. Is there anything we could distinguish between them, or is it just all the same?
Well, you should have the task, right?
Yeah.
So, for example, I currently have a lot of students doing their final thesis, and I cannot change a model every week, right? Stop using Falcon, use Llama 2 now, right? I can't do that.
Okay.
Because it doesn't matter that much, and it's methodology, I think, in this case. You see the description of the data, what goes in there. I think it's the surrounding, and in particular, the task.
Mm-hmm.
Why are you using this for? Right? If once you have the task, I think then the model doesn't matter that much whether they use Kano or any of these large models. It's just fine. Concentrate on the task. And I think...
Is there even a big difference between models?
I mean, there is, but also, again, it depends on what you're doing. Are you an academic looking at it? I think it's also because it's all very easily accessible. And of course, if you follow, even if you're not in academia, you follow what's happening, and then you see all the papers, and it can be hard to really distinguish, hey, what matters and what doesn't. And actually, often the approach is, you step back and wait a bit.
That's what we've always been doing.
You have to wait until stuff catches on. You cannot tell whether something's going to be a thing. And if the community is going to standardize on something, until we wait. Or for example, now if we're looking at the more old school transformer architectures and transformer weights that people now again call LLMs, Bird, Roberta, whatever. There were hundreds, thousands of them. But now the community has largely standardized on a handful. It's Bird, Roberta, Roberta Bayes, for there's a few. And if you wait long enough, you're okay, those are the ones. So it's when we kind of implemented a mini library, so we had better building blocks for transformer architectures in PyTorch. It's called Curated Transformers, a very cool project. And we were we don't have to implement everything. Which one's cool? Here's a handful. Great, done. And that was done by just waiting.
I think what we need are infrastructures that help us to evaluate these language models more efficiently. Mm-hmm. If you look at frameworks like Helm, this holistic evaluation of language models from Stanford, right? If I ask you, well, what metric would you pick, for example, to evaluate language model? Well, it depends on the task, right? Yeah. Even summarization, there are gazillions of different, not gazillions, but dozens of different metrics in this case. And if you look at a paper like this, like Helm, for example, where they have 52 or 54 metrics just for LLMs, right? It's not just prediction and recall, precision and recall. There are so many different things. And I think one better has to know about these things in particular, right? It seems to me that people are setting up some infrastructure and they have no clue about how to evaluate, what metric to pick here in this case. So I think there's also a little bit of education still needs to be done here in this case. And fortunately, there are a whole bunch of good YouTube videos on that, right? So you don't have to go to the university, I have to say. You're still welcome, of course.
Yeah. It's true. I met a math teacher, and she said, it's really hard. The folks on YouTube are just funnier.
Well, but you should know these things as well, right? It's not just hacking. For me, it seems hacking most of the time. Mm-hmm. Oh, it works, great. Next model, and then in this case. But a solid engineering approach, a lot of engineering is missing, I think, here in this case. What do you do? How do you evaluate? How do you choose a metric in this case? How do you compare models, for example? How do you choose efficiency versus performance, and in this case?
Has changed your teaching to say, hey,
Well, I'm in the bad situation. I'm in the process of preparing a new class where I have to cover many of these things. Yeah. So good luck.
if you consider the YouTube playlist.
TikTok is how you reach the new generation.
For Python, advanced programming Python, I did the same. I rather spend the time with the students in the room, hey, let's discuss problems, because I don't really need to, there's content already. Why haven't we preached that? I mean, YouTube is there, there's good content. You can go back, because I always lost track in class, so I think you never can basically.
It is, but there's too much, right? Yeah. For example, what frameworks do you use? Do you Hugging Face? Do you use LangChain? Or what do you use here in this case, right? Mm-hmm. There are so many frameworks in this case, to start with in this case. Even I do not know what to pick here in this case. Like some like PyCharm, others like VS Code, right? So it's like that.
But I think we are not like striving to find like the ideal solution. We never will find it. It's really case by case. For example, for me it's relevant how many languages the model support. Because if for example, in text to speech team we have 65 language support. So and not all the popular models have all that coverage. The latency, can we host it or is it, we need to send API calls, things like that. It's just depending on what are your technical requirements.
Also the content is not clear. What is the model trained on? Which languages, with data sets? Yeah. This is very often blurry or not available as well, right?
Again, here we're back at like reasoning about stuff, looking at the data, and I think a lot of what you describe is stuff like trying to solve things with tech that you should solve with reasoning and like thinking, and that's like, I think that's the general pattern in our society. It's like, ooh, let's solve COVID, let's solve climate change, let's solve poverty with technology, ooh, and it's like, it doesn't work like that.
Yeah, cool. So any final comments?
Let's meet again next year.
Let's
meet again next year.
Can I do something mildly self-promotional? But it's more like, since looking at your data came up and there are lots of academics, we do develop Prodigy, which is a downloadable tool that you own, and it's scripted with Python. I showed it in my talk, and we have a free program for academics. So if you want to use it for research, you can email us.
It's free, so why shame?
That is free. But otherwise, it costs a bit of money, but only once, and it funds
How can students?
Just, I think at the moment, email us. We used to have a form on the website, but if you put something on the website, there are like tons of people who are not actually researchers and work at companies. And once you look them up, you're like, what the fuck? Come on, dude, you work at like insert like tech company here. You have money, like stop. And so that's why we're like, we can't like make it so easy anymore. So you have to email and then tell us where you. I don't know.
the application basically.
We send a form, but it's like if you put it on a website, it like attracts too many people who try to scam.
It's always so good to hear large companies really have to. I mean, it's.
Yeah.
I know it costs money, but it's like not.
But you know, everyone still has their old university email lying around, right? Yeah. And so they're like, "Ooh, I'm a researcher," and I'm like, "No, your LinkedIn says you work for Facebook. Like, can you not?" Research.
So, Alejandro, what's like any final thoughts on large language models to share with the crowd?
I think final thoughts, maybe going back to the trends. I think one of the trends, perhaps, that maybe I can think of, or that I can hope for, is probably going away from chatbots. Is one. Because I mean, I think if you remember back in 2012, there was also like chatbots, and that didn't fly. I mean, that reminded me of the hype on drones, and also the hype on different apps. I think there's a lot of potential with LLMs and technology, but I think it's looking beyond the obvious kind of like here is the LLM in front of you, talk with it. And I think another trend that is interesting is basically it was slightly touched upon, but the use of transformers in different areas, and right now an area that's exploding is forecasting. Demand forecasting. Anything to do with regression based that allows you to perfect regression based models like Sarina or the most traditional ones. I think now also some innovations and transformer based architectures for that. And I think other fields where we're starting to see transformers being kind of like brought into. So basically like the image net moment for different areas. So no thoughts, maybe another shameless plug.
Do you have
free stuff?
Plug?
Free stuff from Zalando, yeah.
Yes. Well, I think he says it. I think he's trying to hire, right? I don't think he's trying to sell shoes. I think I probably bought my shoes at Zalando, actually. They were nice.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, Michael, final thoughts.
I find it an exciting time.
Yeah.
I'm glad that so many people are interested in this, that this technology is easily accessible to people who know a little bit of programming. I think that's cool, right? If you compare it with 10 years ago, how difficult it was to use machine learning at all. So I think this is really cool. It gives you some ideas, and hopefully, especially young people, it motivates them to do something good with that technology. And I think that's an important thing. Not only look at the business, but also try to do something good with
this technology. I think that's an excellent point. Like how accessible, like even the models are that are like millions and millions of dollars to create.
And you see what Google did with this protein folding things and so how it advances fields. And I think in that area we can gain a lot, in particular everything that has to do with public health, with poverty. And so let's also think about how to do this and not just sell stuff to people and convince people to buy something.
I mean, that's it.
So, no.
Somebody
said
it's like
ad tech. It's like the sad reality of the internet. It's
after
like
9 o'clock, so sorry about that.
No, it's quite some time ago. Somebody said that one of the biggest problems in our times is that the smartest people actually are working on selling, like optimizing ads on the internet. Like, and that's sad but true. So Alina, what are your thoughts?
Well, I'm curious on like next development, also what in which creative ways the technology will be used, and hopefully the ethical and security aspect won't be forgotten. I think it also opens access to people who were maybe not interested in technology. Now it's becoming more accessible to them, and that's a good thing. So I'm curious what the future would bring, but there are also old tech that is still functional.
Yeah.
I feel like I talked. Like I sort of inserted myself between all of you, so I feel like I'm kind of done.
All right. Thank you all so much for joining. Get well soon, Alessandra. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, there's always the next time. All right. So this brings us to the next point, that's lightning talks, so bye-bye. So, all right. Yet? The time is not counting because who knows lightning talks? Let me explain you lightning talks a bit while we rearrange our super AI system camera. I probably do that from the other side now.
Okay, it's pretty good.
So lightning talks are 5-minute talks. So you can basically say 5 minutes, you can talk about anything which is appropriate. And
yeah, what is appropriate? Actually, anything yet that's not in the CEO's code of conduct. Sorry, it's complicated here. All right, so walking around. So yeah, you can just like talk 5 minutes about everything. But 5 minutes, no Q&A. It's, and that's it. And basically 30 seconds before I'm doing that, and then you all start as well. And after 5 minutes, you all clap, no matter where the lightning talk speaker stands. And let me just fix the camera thing here. Tension. Camera needs to restart. For going portrait mode, that's the whole thing. So there it is. Yes, let me make you a bit bigger. Yes, we're getting there. It's life. Wonderbar. So. Unfortunately, OBS never remembers this, and that's really bad. So, I don't know. We all set up. Let's move this a bit further away. You can see all what you see on the screen there. And, oh, please give a big hand to PyData.
Yeah, welcome to my lightning talk, Polarify Syntactic Sugar for your conditional Polex expressions. First off, who has actually heard about polars? Okay, quite some few. So consider this pandas example on the left here, which is just some standard pandas code where we want to find our top paying customers. So top paying customers being customers who paid more than 500 euros in total over their whole contract duration, and we do so by first figuring out like the daily rate they paid, then how long they actually were our customers. So we figure out the number of days the contract ran and then just filter it. The equivalent Polar's code would look something like this, with the main difference being that instead of how Pandas computes this, doing the computation step by step and computing all the intermediate results, so the number of days you were a customer and the total price and then only filtering, we first build up a symbolic expression which can then be evaluated upon your data frame. So here we craft up this expression which is not actually directly computing anything, and then we can call this filter function on the data frame and filter out all rows where this is being larger than 500. So this was great. We can also do this saves a lot of intermediate storing of intermediate results. So this results in a great speed up. And we can also do conditional expressions. So consider we have some column X, which is just a number, and we want to find the signum function of this number. So the equivalent Polar's code would look something like this, where we would use this Polar's when then otherwise chain. And as you can see, the condition goes in here. And if this is true, it should return one. And if it's not the case, it will do a nested statement like this. But you can also kind of see the problem here, where it becomes quite a bit hard to read and write, especially if nesting comes into play. And this is where Polarify comes into the picture. Instead of having to write this function on the left manually, you can just add a function decorator to your signum function, and Polarify will then convert the AST of your function into a Polar's expression. So consider we have some expression to get our number x here. We can just pass it into the signum function and get out a new expression, which will be the signum function value of your expression, essentially. So let's take a quick look at how Polarify does this. Polarify goes through your function body statement by statement and keeps track of all the assignments you have made along the way and what conditions it has encountered. So we start off with this first statement with S being just assigned 0. And then we go on to the first condition statement. So we note down that if X has been larger than 0, S will be assigned to 1. And if it's not the case, S will still remain at 0. We then reach this second conditional block, elif. Remember, elif is just syntactic sugar for a if block inside the else clause. So we replace this S being equal to 0 statement down here with another conditional block. And now the condition is if X is being smaller than 0, S will be assigned to minus 1. And if not, S will still remain at 0. We then reach this return statement, and now we need to figure out what S final value will be in each branch. So we basically just inline S with the final value. We can look it up in the assignment we have kept have been keeping track of, and then have built up this graph, which notes down what each branch should return. Now Polarify only needs to translate this into a final Polar's expression. So this is pretty straightforward. We copy this condition here inside as the argument for this when function call. The left side goes in the as the argument for this then function call, and the right side will be the otherwise call. We do this recursively and get out the final expression, and then Polarify will just replace the function body with the Polar's expression, so you can use it throughout your code base. So this was a super quick look at how Polarify works. If you want to check it out in detail, please feel free to do so at our GitHub repository. You can find Polarify on PyPy and ConnorForge, and thanks for your attention.
Thank you.
No questions on Lightning Talks.
Too bad, is it?
Yeah.
Here you go. Just clip that on. And
I will switch here. And yes. Here you go. I think that's. Yeah.
So just this, right?
Yes. Right. Mm-hmm. So. Okay, so I'm going to set the watch now. So
me too.
Oh, wow.
Oh no, wait, and how can I stop the auto, you know, it's automatically switching. It's switching automatically through the time, no?
No? I don't think so.
Okay, I hope so.
Maybe it, yeah, it was quite interesting. Usually it's not.
Okay, let's start.
But it's, oh yeah, let me set the timer. Just one, two, three, moment, so. Yeah, now stop, yeah.
So hello everyone. This is indeed my name. I am Irina Smirnova-Pinchukova. I did my PhD in astronomy at MPIA, and now I am looking for a job. And today I decided to talk not about these beautiful galaxies I've talked so much during the last few years, but rather about something I've never given a talk about before. It's about my hobby. So this is my latest, or one of the latest, crochets. So my hobby is to crochet, specifically toys. What I love the most about my hobby is when a toy becomes a character, it kind of becomes alive, and this is an incredible feeling. That is why I often prefer to crochet cartoon characters. So why Python? This is PyData. Have you crocheted a Python? You would ask if only the questions were allowed during lightning talks. So to define a problem I am solving with Python, I have to step back and talk about crochet a little bit. In two-dimensional or flat crochet, there is absolutely no problem. There are many beautiful knots. They all have names and symbols. And to design something, you can simply sketch it with a pen and a piece of paper and then do an actual thing. And this chain of the text instructions where you write down what to crochet knot by knot, row by row, the visualization, which is simply done, and the actual thing works perfectly. Now let's go through the process of designing a toy together. For example, I want to crochet this little Totoro friend from My Neighbor Totoro cartoon. I can look at it from different perspectives to understand its shape a bit more. And now we need to go to a three-dimensional crochet. Good news, I do not need no fancy knots to crochet, only the simplest one. And also, I have an idea how to start. I have an idea how to crochet. I can write down some instructions. Bad news, the visualization step is missing. So I have no idea what's written here. I don't have such a great imagination, and it's impossible to draw it with a pen and a paper. So what often happens is that I look at the toy, and I think, oh no, I wish the proportion was just a little bit different. And you can imagine that the bigger the toy is, the more tragic the decision to rip off half of it, change a little bit, and then repeat hundreds of the same knot over again, it just can be pain. So I'm developing a tool with Python I called Crochapes, where it reads this text, these instructions, with regular expressions and creates a network X graph. Now, all I have to do is to visualize this graph. I use it with Kamada Kawaii layout, which is a force-directed graph drawing method. It treats a graph as a physical model and minimizes this energy function for each node with the strongest force iteratively. And now I can decide which proportion is more kawaii beforehand, and then I can crochet my toy only one time. So if you are interested in looking at these models in a more interactive way, to rotate it and also look at the different graphs, I have Crochapes on my laptop and I can show you. And of course, the actual result is here.
Thanks for the microphone. So, that was... signal now?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. So if you want to stay in touch, join our LinkedIn group to keep you up to date. Also, if you like this event, if you like to contribute a talk, reach out to us. That's important that we have speakers and know new things and applications. There's going to be the next PyData is going to be in Karlsruhe. We're going to be at the 17th of November at Blue Yonder. Also, we have a date for the 5th of December at Heidelberg Materials, just around the corner here.
Keep this community going. If you have support, rate the event on Meetup. We have amazing event, actually ratings. It's, send us emails. You can always reach out. Oh, it's not working. Maybe it's empty. So thank you. So I'll put that just there. Host sponsor us, and thanks to our sponsors. Thanks for Hio Innovation for hosting this amazing event. Actually, I think it was the biggest PyData Südwest ever. So we had like 220 people sign up. More people joined the live stream. It was pretty amazing, and we even had to use the overflow room for the streaming because not everybody could fit in here. That was like super amazing. Thanks to Königsweg and Sia for providing all these crazy things I propose, and for the community. And he also says, "Yeah, let's do it," because we work with open source, and this is our way to contribute back. Also, thanks again to the Python Software Verband for supporting us. But also, thanks Reddit. So thanks to our speakers, Ines, Alejandro, yeah, Alina, and Michael. There, Michael. Yeah, also to the Lightning Talk speakers, Bela and Irina. Johanna from High Innovation for host organization. Zia and Martin for food organization. Team Hauk for catering. I think. Kevin for video ops. Benedict for Q&A. Lucas for taking photos. Uwe for tweeting this event. I think we didn't use it, but also thanks for the food task force, Uwe, Pavel, and Zia. Just in case we ran out of food, they would have got more food in. Yeah, thank you, and bye-bye.